I'll open us up in prayer and then do our call to worship. All right, let's pray. Lord, we ask you to bless this time, Lord. We ask you to quiet our hearts and allow us to be in a position to worship you wholly and completely. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Turn your Bibles to Matthew 5. Matthew chapter 5. We'll be looking at just the first few verses of Matthew 5. This is Jesus preaching on the Sermon on the Mount. So when we're looking at how to get our hearts ready for worship, we'll have a moment of silent prayer in a moment. But let's reflect on how Jesus started his sermon here. Matthew chapter 5, we'll start in verse 1, and we'll read the first six verses. Matthew 5, 1. And seeing the multitudes, he went up into the mountains, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, and they shall be filled. Specifically in verse 6, it talks about hungering and thirsting after righteousness. And Jesus made that a point when he was starting his sermon so they could get their hearts ready. As we go into a moment of silent prayer, there might be a lot of distractions throughout the week. I know the weather wasn't the greatest, but we have a moment to reflect and reset our hearts and minds as we come to the prayer, the moment of prayer in a second. But the point that I want to look at this at the end of verse 6, it says, For they shall be filled. Shall be. What does that mean? That means that's a promise. If we come hungry and thirsty, God promises that we shall be filled. So as we go to silent prayer in a moment, that's what I would encourage you to pray to the Lord for today. Lord, as we start this service, Lord, we ask you to work in our hearts, to quiet them and make them open and ready to accept your truths. In Christ's name, amen. Paul?
Let's take our hymn books and turn to number 40. Number 40, please. Great is thy faithfulness. Let's stand as we sing.
Thank you.
right, as you're grabbing your seats this morning, I'd just like to point out to those of you who are less than enthusiastic at times about being in the auditorium, that's why we torture the infants downstairs. We get them screaming, and then you know it's better upstairs than it is downstairs. I want you to pause for just a second and to consider the earliest memories that each of those children will have will be so entwined with the existence of Jesus Christ that they will not know life without the gospel. And so thank God for the crying voices downstairs. You know what I mean? Like, wow, see, I was 7 when I heard about the Lord the first time. Some of you were in your 20s and in your 30s. And so those of us who had to wait any amount of time to hear the gospel are in awe that God started this church 15 years ago. When we first got started, we were all brand new together, and so to know that the Lord is now raising up generations of believers is really exciting. So we want to welcome you this morning. If you've never been here to Faith Baptist Church, I'm pausing looking for some brand new faces. We have some to welcome you. And so the guys are going to come back toward the back of the auditorium with a card and a pen, and they're going to offer that to you. Just go ahead and take the card, fill it out as much as you're comfortable with. You can keep the pen as a reminder of your visit today. Hopefully every time you use that pen, you'll be reminded of the things that God did in your life, bringing you to our ministry today. But the card is just simply designed to connect with you, to get to know you better. I would encourage you to take a look at both sides of that card. Fill it out as much as you're comfortable with. When the offering plate comes by later, and it's going to come by twice today, you say twice. I'll explain. There's good reason behind it. But either one of those times, you can take that card, drop it in the offering plate. The guys collect them and set them on my desk. It's just designed not only for us to get to know you better, but for us to hopefully be a blessing to you, because we consider it a big deal that the Lord brought you to us today. So guys, would you please make your way to the back looking for those brand new faces? Brother Bill, I know you're going to see an unfamiliar face in Dr. Anderson, but he doesn't get one of those cards, all right? We're very, very glad to have the Andersons with us. Hey, there you go. Got a free pen out of the deal. Amen. Every time Dr. Anderson uses that. I asked him if it was okay if I called him Pastor Dave today. So let me explain just a little bit who this dear friend is to us. He is the president over at Maranatha Baptist University. That's the college that I graduated from, over in Watertown, Wisconsin. A town where most have never heard, and yet the impact of the Lord's ministry is felt around the world from Watertown, Wisconsin. And so we're very thankful for their ministry. We'll talk a little bit more about why I would call him Pastor Dave, but we are excited to have Dr. Anderson here this morning and Dr. Marriott. I got it right twice. Dr. Marriott here this evening. We've got a very special day planned. We're excited about it. We've also got a couple other new things going on that we're going to be pointing out to you, but let's keep worshiping together. If you would please grab your hymn books. I don't mean to steal Brother Paul's thunder. He's going to come and lead you in this next song, number 473. And I heard you sing this morning. You were doing pretty good. And number 40, Great Is Thy Faithfulness, is a contemplative song, but this next one's a celebration song. So I know that you don't want to miss the chance to celebrate. It's good for you to see the words so you know what you're celebrating. Number 473 is what you're going to sing next. And I go out of the way to point this out, so that our hearts are truly engaged, giving Jesus the very best we possibly can. Look at the first verse. Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful day. Pause for just a second and think, when's the last time you had not just a wonderful day, but a wonderful, wonderful day? This should have your attention. What are you going to give God glory for? It's a day I will never forget, after I had wandered in darkness away, Jesus, my Savior, I met. Oh, what a tender, compassionate friend. He met the need of my heart. Shadows dispelling, with joy I am telling, he made all the darkness depart. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. I hope that you can sing with your entire heart. I hope that you know Jesus as your Savior. I mentioned this already. I was 7 years old when I asked Jesus to save me. And when he came in, sorrow departed. And I've got great news for you. If you don't have that day in your life, I am confident that God is going to give you that day if you desire it. So it's going to be an awesome morning. Let's go ahead and sing this with a deep connection to that moment when Jesus Christ redeemed us. Do you remember when it was? It's the greatest story you could ever tell. Brother Paul, come and lead us in number 473, sir.
the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, that old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. The dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a cross I will ever be true, its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a exchange it someday for a crown. It doesn't matter how old that song is, it bites into your heart, doesn't it? It is our pleasure to have Dr. Anderson here. Now, I would normally introduce him. I'm not going to do that this morning, and there's a very good reason why. I'll just simply tell you why I like to call him Pastor Dave. When I graduated Maranatha in 2007, we had no idea what the next step would be. And when we said yes to an internship at Faith Baptist Church in Warren, we had no idea what God was actually bringing us into. Cherry and I left Wisconsin. Everyone was shocked because they all said we would never move. We were the ones that were going to stay close to home. But I'll tell you what, you follow the Lord, his feet will take you in places you never imagined. So we ended up over here in Detroit. I didn't even know where Detroit was. I knew it was in Michigan. I didn't know that it was on the far side of Michigan. And it wasn't until we flew here the first time. And Dr. Marriott presented us to the ministry, and they, with loving and opening arms, accepted us at Faith Baptist Church of Warren. And I got to be a part of a miraculous time at Faith Baptist Church. Pastor Marriott was the senior pastor. Pastor Dave was the assistant pastor. Pastor Brian was the associate pastor to the children's ministries. And then we had Brother Matt Fenton out at the school. And I had the privilege of every week spending a little bit of time with each of those men to get ready to become the pastor at Faith Baptist Church of Northern Macomb County. And so to me, although everyone else calls him Dr. Anderson, he's Pastor Dave in my heart. There are many people that invested in Cherry and I to allow us to be in ministry, but there were some that went out of the way. And Pastor Dave is one of those men that went out of the way to help me understand what it meant to pastor people. Now, I'm not going to introduce him, obviously. So I probably already have. Brother Mark Scally, I'm going to ask him to come on up, one of our deacons. We try to keep our deacons as involved in the worship service as possible, not only because we want to hear from their heart, but because I want you to see them and to be praying for them. But this is different. Brother Mark Scally, very respectfully last week, asked, is there any way, if you say no, that's totally fine, but is there any way that I could introduce him? And he has very, very good reasons for why he wanted to introduce Pastor Dave today, Dr. Anderson. I'll turn it over to Brother Mark Scally.
Well, I guess I don't have to welcome him anymore. No, I'm kidding. I will echo a lot of what Pastor Boudreaux said. It is truly an honor to have Dr. Anderson here with us today. It feels very strange to call him that, as for me, as well as some of you here who were at Faith down in Warren, and know him as Pastor Dave, and will always probably know him as Pastor Dave. It was probably around this time, about 25 years ago, actually over 25 years ago, and when I wrote that and read it back, I had to stop and reread it a few times. Feels weird to say over 25 years ago. I was one of the new teens, and that year was especially exciting and unique because we had a new youth pastor that year, Pastor Dave. But the Lord knew exactly what we needed, and over the next 6 years of watching Pastor Dave's humble example, I got to learn what it meant to follow Christ and serve others. Even though I occasionally needed to be dragged along myself, but there are plenty of stories for that. I got to see an example of how to be a godly husband and a godly father, even in the face of loss. Through missions trips to New York, Alabama, Nova Scotia, and even Cambodia, I learned what it meant to serve in a local ministry. While Pastor Dave showed us that serving the Lord is rewarding, at times he showed us that it sometimes requires rolling up your sleeves and getting to work doing hard things. And through it all, I always knew that I could come to Pastor Dave with any questions, and he would rightly divide the word of truth and point me to Christ. So when I say that it is an honor to have Dr. Anderson, or Pastor Dave, here with us today, it's because I am 100% confident from personal experiences in my life that God is going to use him today to do a good work in our hearts. Pastor Dave.
Amen. Well, you're making me cry already, and that's not fair. This is what a joy to be here, to be with you folks. Obviously, faces that I don't know, faces that I do. A blessing. We're rejoicing what God's accomplishing in northern Macomb County. All right, Ray Township. There we go. Northern Macomb County. I got it all right. There we go. What a joy and blessing. Let's grab our Bibles, go to Acts chapter 28 this morning. You are going to get a blessing tonight with the Marriotts being here, and what a joy and blessing. So many of you would know him and remember his battle with cancer. He's had heart issues over the last couple of years, and the Lord has strengthened him. So a procedure just about a month and a half ago has just turned him around,
and he is just energetic and well-to-do as far as physically. Yes, the cancer's still there, and you continue to pray for him, but he's a walking miracle. You know, according to all medical diagnoses, he should have been in glory already for a few years. And here he is still serving now. For me, what a joy. So going to Maranatha a little over a year ago now, Pastor Troy just kind of mentioned, he says, you know, God always has adventures for us in his will. This was not planned. In fact, we had just been endeared to the church family there in Illinois and felt like maybe the Lord was just going to keep us there through retirement, just enjoy it. It was in many ways a green pasture for us. God was doing some great work. And we loved it. We were sitting in an idyllic setting. We're in a county of about 300,000 people, Rockford area, all right? We're on the north end of Rockford, just south of Beloit, Wisconsin. So we had, our church family was split, about 50% Wisconsinites, 50% Illinoisans, and they annoy you. Anyways, no. and yet we sat on 10 acres of land. The parsonage was in the back of the back 40, all right, the back five of the 10 acres. Our neighbors to the north were really quiet. It was a cemetery. The neighbors to the south were several horses. Our neighbor boarded horses, so it was not uncommon for us to get up, open up the windows in the morning. There's the horses out, you know, just this idyllic scene and beautiful picture and so forth. It was just a delightful place, and yet we had so many souls to reach. They were all around us. There was never a time where we wondered where could we go now for calling or whatever. And then our church sat literally on a road that everybody in that area of the country drove on. Thousands of cars would go by our church every day. So we would very commonly have walk-ins. We've driven by this church for the last 10 years, thought we'd stop and come on in. Thank you for being here. So unique opportunities to share the gospel and those kinds of things. And then I got this, it's, you know, how we talk about December 7th. You know, FDR told us it's the day that will live in infamy. Well, I have a day that will live in infamy in my life. It's March 31 of 2023. I see Dr. Jackson, Doug Jackson, pastor up at Saginaw. He said, he's calling me. Well, I was serving on the board at Maranatha, so I thought, well, what's going on? And Dr. Jackson, if you know anything about him, he's short and sweet and hard to beat kind of thing. He's just right at it. Lots of fun to be around, but he doesn't mess around with getting work done. The guy has accomplished some amazing things for the Lord, and that's because he just never stops. He just keeps on going. So I pick up the phone. Dr. Jackson, how you doing? Hey, Dave, how would you like to be the president of Maranatha? I mean, that was the conversation. It was just... hang on here. What? and so that was a season, frankly, we spent, Abby and I, our life was just really in a tailspin for about a week, seeking the Lord, asking his wisdom. And I will tell you that God's will is always affirmed through your life in many different ways. My father has been a pastor for years and years. He's fully retired at this point from pastoring. When he retired from ministry, he came down and joined us at Heritage in Roscoe. Was my assistant, one of my assistant pastors. It was just a joy and delight. So, I don't know, it was about a week in or so, I finally called Dad and said, what do you think? And his dad is a steady Eddie guy. He's a farmer. That's what he grew up farming. He's a plotter. God prospered his ministry in so many ways among farmers in Wisconsin. Planted a church. It's still going, flourishing today, those kinds of things. Just amazing stories. But for Dad, usually the cup is half empty, not half full. I mean, his natural reaction is no. It's, no, we'll just keep on going where we're at. And that was, so when I told him, he said, David, you're nuts, essentially. He said, thanks, Dad. I expected you to say that. Anyways, but then it was the same day. It was a few hours later, maybe it was into the evening. He called me back. And he said, David, I must apologize. He said, David, I want you to do God's will. And for my father to tell me that was just, even in that moment, just a precious blessing. It was one of those steps along the way to say, this is what God wants you to do. I don't know why, but this is what God wants you to do. So obviously, we couldn't tell the church families who went through all this process. But as we finally announced it to our church family, it was a joy to hear them affirm it too. I mean, we're all crying together. As you can tell, I'm a crybaby. And after the service that first, I said, folks, I'm God's servant. That's all I am. I'm just his servant. I just need to follow whatever God wants. And so lots of hugs, but lots of people came up and said, oh, Pastor, we knew. It's like, well, why didn't you tell me? Anyways, so that affirmation of God's people for God's steps and God's will in your life is so critical. As you make big decisions here, folks, your church family should be the people that come alongside and say, amen, we see it too. If they don't, you should question what you're doing. That's what God has given us his family for. What a blessing. So anyway, a joy to be there. We want all your kids to come to Maranatha, so just come on. There you go. There's my promo for Maranatha, all right? We'll love on them as best we can. The youth group has grown, Mark. The youth group has grown, all right? Down at Faith and Warren, we were having high days of often about 100 in the youth group on a regular basis. Well, now I've got like 420 youth group kids, all right, on campus. The bad thing is they're always running everywhere. It's like, stop, would you talk to me? But we try to minister and serve. It's a delight to be a part. There's lots of folks, there's just a lot of good godly faculty and staff there too. As I've been there just observing, there's God's servants there. Every one of them, it's just a delight to see them with their whole heart wanting to accomplish God's work and will in the lives of these young people. That's just a huge blessing. I'm glad that God has put me there. So, all right, Acts chapter 28. We're in Acts chapter 28 this morning. Have you ever, Pastor Troy mentioned, I guess that you've just looked at this recently, just briefly, but Acts, well, if you looked in chapter 1, verse 1, it says this is the continuing work of Jesus Christ. So what he had begun to do in the Gospels, in the book of Acts, Christ is continuing. Now, wait a second. Christ in chapter 1 of Acts ascends, right? It's like he's out of here. How could he say that he's continuing his work? Well, the simple answer is you and I. We are, in every local setting, the body of Christ. He is the head of this church. Pastor Troy is not. We all know that, right? Christ is the head of this church, and he is the shepherd to help us all follow the Lord here, right? Now, the same thing happens in the book of Acts. So though Christ is not seen, he's very much alive and well and working. And we see the wonderful unfolding of that story without the personal presence of Christ in the sense of his physical presence, but his spiritual work through the Spirit of God, by the Word of God, affecting lives, the gospel spreading throughout Asia and Europe. Christ was at work. Now, I don't know about you, but when I read a story, and Acts is a story, it's a narrative, all right? It just tells us history. It's not a doctrinal book like some of the epistles. It's just a story. So I'm one of those guys that I hate bad endings to a story. I like always want a happy ending. That's why me and Disney get along. I mean, the former Disney, not the one now. Anyways, all right. It's like, you got to have a happy ending. Now, I will give you a little bit of spiritual reason for that. Don't all of us as believers have a happy ending coming? All right, so it's a right, all right? So all you guys that like the dark stories, something wrong with you. No, God's just made you different. There you go, okay. So, you get to the book of Acts, you come to chapter 28 here, and it's like, well, what's the end of the story? Paul's left in prison, he's preaching, and the end of, that's not the end of a story. Like, what happened to Paul? Like, what happened to the church there in Rome? Like, what happened to all the other churches? Well, that's actually the point, because the story's not done yet. Do you realize that you and I here today are still a part of the story of the book of Acts? We are still a part of the work of Christ that's ongoing in this dispensation in this time. That's pretty cool. All of a sudden, I kind of see our names, you know, I don't know, are we on chapter like 1,000 now? But isn't that neat? So, when God writes stories in his word, it's not just for our enjoyment. It's not just to kind of help us find ourselves in our history, to know our roots. No, he tells stories very much on purpose to set an example. In fact, Paul tells us that in 1 Corinthians 10. These are written for your, the King James word, in samples. We haven't used that often, do we? In samples, all right, for our example to follow. So there's something here in Acts 28 that I think the Lord wants us to follow. So would you walk with me today? We're going to walk through chapter 28. This is not going to be an extremely deep message because it's a narrative. It's not supposed to be. You're supposed to catch the highlights and then live it out. And there's the truth. So walk with me today as we walk through chapter 28. It's like the final chapter written about the story of Christ's work with all kinds of clues along the way for helping us today follow the Lord and be the continuing work of Christ here in Ray Township. Verse 1. And when they were escaped, now what did they escape? Well, chapter 27 is the great shipwreck story, all right? Paul on his way to Rome because he was a prisoner, put him on ship. They run into Euroclydon, all right? A nor'easter. The days when I lived out in Pennsylvania, we experienced several nor'easters in this massive, massive wind come up the East Coast. And usually it seemed like in the wintertime, and it would dump a whole pile of snow. I mean, like overnight, 2 feet of snow. Boom. All right? Hey, no school. That's great. But they don't have snow equipment out there. It's like, what in the world? You're buried for a week, you know? You unbury your car. Well, there's like 4 feet of snow behind it that the street people haven't even done anything with. See, it sits there. Anyways, a nor'easter. So it throws his ship way off course. They're about to die. Paul says, listen, you should have listened to me when we sailed out of on the eastern side of Cyprus and not gone to the west side. They were wanting to get a harbor that was, for the sailors, a party town. That's really what they wanted. So they thought, we'll get around. No, you should have listened to me, Paul said. But I've got a good God whom I serve, and he's promised that not one of us is going to lose our life. So they're heading slightly towards Italy at this point, finally. Their ship is broken. It finally gets caught on a sandbar. It breaks up. They all get on the land, swimming, grabbing a piece of board, and getting to land. And that's where we're at right here in verse 1. So they all escape, and they knew that the island was Melita. It's about 60 miles south of Sicily, all right? Some of you Italians here, Sicilians, all right? There you go. There's just 60 miles south of home country area, all right? And the barbarous people, now we think of barbarians as being mean people. No, this just means foreign, all right? They didn't speak the same language. So the guys on the ship, the people on the island, Melita, spoke different languages. There was probably, obviously, someone there to translate. Obviously, Greek was the trade language, like English is today, the trade language. So they were able to somehow communicate. But it's a fitting description. They were foreigners, right? The foreign people showed us no little kindness, for they kindled a fire and received us everyone because of the present rain and because of the cold, all right? You're still kind of in winter, all right? And even though it's the Mediterranean, it's cold and nasty. And when Paul had gathered a bundle of sticks and laid them on the fire, there came a viper out of the heat and fastened on his hand. And when the barbarians saw the venomous beast hang on his hand, they said among themselves, no doubt this man is a murderer, whom though he hath escaped the sea, yet vengeance, and they're talking about a goddess called Vengeance, their god, one of their gods, vengeance suffereth not to live. Now, talk about jumping to conclusions, huh? All right, they see this guy, he's got a snake on his hand, he throws it in the fire, he's a murderer. You never do that, do you? Like prejudge people? See them once and have their story all written up. It's a little bit of human nature here going on, right? All right. All right. But look what happens. Verse 5. Then he shook off the beast into the fire and felt no harm. Howbeit, they looked, all right, so the barbarous people looked, when he should have swollen or fallen down dead suddenly. I mean, it's like they're all standing around the edges watching this guy. Like they're supposed to be gathering sticks for the fire to help him. All of a sudden, there's a show going on. What's going to happen? He's a murderer. Yeah. Watch. He's going to get it right now. All right. That's where they're at. He should have fallen down suddenly. But after they had looked a great while, I wonder if Paul knew that they were staring at him. I don't know. Anyway, okay. And saw no harm came to him, they changed their minds and said that he was a god. From one minute, he's a murderer. Now he's a god. Wow. fickle people, all right? it sounds like our political situation right now, all right? Okay, all right. This has been going on since about the fall of Adam and Eve, just so you know, all right? People are fickle like this. Now, what's going on? in the same quarters, verse 7, there were possessions of the chief man of the island, whose name was Publius. There are young ladies, here's a great name for your next child, all right? Publius, there you go. All right, now Publius received us and lodged us 3 days courteously. So there's some courteousness going on. And it came to pass that the father of Publius lay sick of a fever and of a bloody flux. All right, probably dysentery. To whom Paul entered in and prayed, laid his hands on him, and healed him. So when this was done, others also which had diseases in the island came and were healed, who also honored us with many honors. Let's stop there for a second. Why would God tell us this interesting, very interesting, as you can see, somewhat, in my opinion at least, humorous story? Why was that included? Well, here's why. Notice what happens as I've gotten down to Publius and his father-in-law, all right, lay sick. I'm sorry, it's father, not his father-in-law, lay sick. And Paul comes in and does what an apostle would often do. The apostles were gifted to bring glory to God and affirm the preaching and teaching of the gospel. Now, we don't have the whole story here. It becomes very evident we don't have the whole story. And we don't need it. By this point in the book of Acts, we already know Paul's routine and manner. Did he preach the gospel here? Well, we don't see it recorded, but what would be the answer? Of course he would. That's what he's always done. That's his custom. That's his habit. It said that several times through the book of Acts. So we don't need to know the reality that, yes, of course he preached. Why would God use a miracle there if it was just simply to heal the father? No, it wasn't just for that. You see, even Christ did not use his miracles just flippantly. It wasn't to show off. No. It was very much on purpose to point the people to the truth that there is a God who's perfect and holy. You and I are sinners. And that God has sent a Savior, Jesus Christ, to be the mediator, the propitiation for our sins. That's why there was a miracle there. Now, you say, well, I don't do miracles. Thank you, don't, okay? It's not your job. I can tell you pretty firmly, it's not your job to do miracles today, okay? Why? Well, we have all that we need for life and for godliness right here. 2 Peter 1:3. All right, but is there something for me to learn from this? I think so. So here's a question to ask. In light of what Paul just did here, does my life, like Paul's, does my life demonstrate the greatness of God? Paul flicks the snake into the fire. He's not harmed. Is that a miracle? It obviously is. He probably should have been dead. How many lives does Paul have? I don't know, like 9, 10. And yet God intervenes. Why? Well, he wanted to keep Paul around, but more importantly, he wanted to reach some people on Miletus for the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why. And the demonstration of God's greatness through the life of Paul, the healing of Publius' father, would cause them to say, whose God is Paul's God? It's definitely not vengeance, because he beat vengeance, right? Make sense? Does your life do that for the people around you? Last night we were walking to the hotel. So being connected now with a ministry that's somewhat known around the country, you never know who you're going to run into. That's just the truth. So I'm walking in, I carry almost all the luggage in. We stepped over to my wife's brother, lives down in Warren, so we'd been over to their house for a little bit, come back. Well, I have my suits and my shirts in hand. I don't have a garment bag on them, because that gets them wrinkled, all right? So you put them, I'm just carrying them in off the rod in the car. I'm walking up the steps in the motel, right? Not taking the elevator, walking up the steps. It has a nice big open atrium. Those of you that were down in Warren, it's the Holiday Inn, all right, down there, right on 11 Mile there. Anyway, so walk in a nice open atrium. And this guy literally jumps up from the table. What do you want? He says, Dave! Yeah, that's me. And I'm trying to think, who's this guy? Who's this guy? Who's this guy? Who's this guy? Well, he was at Maranatha when I was at Maranatha back. He went there from 79 to 85. I was there from 81 to 88 or so through. Anyway, so he says, I cut your hair. Yeah, you probably did. I guess you did. I don't remember. Anyways, But he jumped up. He's just so happy. Oh, I've been praying for you. How's it going? Vito is his name. Well, he said, you know what? And I said, well, I'm here. My wife and kids are here. He says, yeah, I saw them already. We figured, he didn't know them from Adam. He said, but we figured they were Christians. We figured it out. It's like, glory. So whatever my wife, Drew, thank you for not making a mess of things here when you walked into the hotel last night, right? Whatever they did was a testimony. It was demonstrating at some level the greatness of God. Does your life do that? You go to work tomorrow. Do people know that your God is great? I'm reminded, we read from Matthew chapter 5 this morning. You should have kept on reading, John. You should have kept on reading. Verse 16. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your what? Good works. And what? Glorify your Father which is in heaven. Here's Paul living out a principle from the Sermon on the Mount. His good works were glorifying his Father. Now, what are you doing about that? If God's going to continue to use Faith Baptist Church and use your life, well, then you better be about demonstrating the greatness of God. Now, another point from these verses here. Point number two, another question to ask yourself. Do you give your life in service to others? Now, we see in Paul's example here again, just an amazing thought. He's just been through a shipwreck, and yet God points out that he's picking up sticks to build a fire. Now, you say, well, that's self-preservation. I suppose at some level it is, but he wasn't so highfalutin. He wasn't the apostle on the ship. I mean, he had Luke along. Luke could do the work. Come on, Luke, Dr. Luke, you get the work done. No. He just jumped in. There was work to be done. He jumped in. There was sort of, and then, all right, he finds out about Publius' father. Well, I can help this guy. No, it doesn't seem like he asks any question. He just knows immediately what he needs to do. He's jumping in right away to service. Dear believer in Christ, do you spend your life in service for your Lord to others? We're not called to a little high hill someplace to cloister ourselves from this world. Where God's planted you, get at it. Start serving the Lord. Infect the people that are around you. They need help. We'll jump in and give a hand. None of us are too lowly or too great to do the low jobs, all right? Let us be about throwing some sticks on the fire. Let us be about helping point a person to Christ. Let's keep on reading. I stopped in verse 10, so let's start there. So also, who also honored us with many honors, and when we departed, they laded us with such things as were necessary. And after 3 months, we departed in a ship of Alexandria, which had wintered in the isle, whose sign was Castor and Pollux. All right, these are divinities as well for the sailors. All right, they thought that somehow that would protect them. No, what protected them was Paul being on the ship, I think, and God's children. God watches over his kids. All right, that's just great. Verse 12, and we landed at Syracuse. This is not Syracuse, New York. All right. We tarried there for 3 days, all right? Syracuse is actually on Sicily, all right? And then they got back in the boat, and from thence we fetched a compass and came to Rhegium. This is on the toe of Italy. And after one day, the south wind blew and came the next day to Ptolemy. Now, I mispronounce that all the time. Puteoli, all right? Puteoli was actually Rome's harbor. Rome's harbor was really shallow. So back in the day, almost all the ships that were coming to Rome would come to Puteolio. Where we found, all right, so they land, and verse 14, where we found brethren and were desired to tarry with them 7 days. And how does this work? Now, wait a second. Paul's a Roman prisoner on a ship with a bunch of sailors. They land, so this Roman centurion and his soldiers are heading to Rome. I suspect they would love to get into town pretty quickly so that their job is done, right? Typical. Somehow, the brethren in verse 14, now who's brethren? These are Paul's brethren. These are believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, beloved people. Somehow they stop the whole show. And they make them stay for 7 days. I don't know. Did they have some big feast for the soldiers? I bet you they had to feed them. This is one of those parts of scripture I want to ask, all right, when I get to heaven, what did you do? How did you do that? How did you stop them for 7 days? But Whatever happened, let's keep on reading because verse 15 is really cool. And from thence, when the brethren heard of us, so more brethren heard, they came to meet us as far as Appii Forum and the Three Taverns, that's the name of a town, whom when Paul saw, notice, here it is, sit up, pay attention, here's God's narrative, all right? When Paul saw, he thanked God and took courage. A third question to ask ourselves today. As we serve the Lord, want to be the continuing work of Christ in this place, does my life cause others to give thanks to God and to find encouragement to continue to serve the Lord? So here I'm focusing literally on the people that came in car, those people that for 7 days came alongside and picked him up, helped his hand, and then as he gets on the way, the brethren hear from him, and he's coming down, and he's just so encouraged in the work, and he thanks God for them. Thank you, God, for sending some people that encouraged my heart. I know that you're still with me. Now, when was the last time you saw Jesus with your physical eyes? Don't raise your hand, all right? None of us, of course not. But can we, in a real sense, say Christ was putting his arms around Paul through the children of God that came alongside him, right? Oh, God, thank you. You haven't forsaken me. God's people are still here. Okay, God, I know that I'm heading to my trial, but I'm going to take courage. Stand strong. And we have testimonies, by the way, in the pastoral's epistles. No man stood with him. And yet, God was with him. I'm sure these people encouraged his heart in that moment. Dear brother and sister in Christ, stop and think this past week. Did you encourage any brother or sister in Christ in their walk with the Lord? They're more anxious to serve God or got back on the path? That's a big part of our ministry as a church. You know that we're kind of few and far between, right? In the big picture of this world, believers that love the Lord are sitting in church like this today are rather small. Well, we need each other. Come on. Be an encouragement to each other, all right? Let's cause each other to thank the Lord. Let's hasten on. And when we came to Rome, the centurion delivered the prisoners to the captain of the guard, but Paul was suffered to dwell by himself with a soldier that kept guard over him. And it came to pass that after 3 days, Paul called the chief of the Jews together, and when they were come together, he said unto them, Men and brethren, though I have committed nothing against the people or customs of our fathers, yet was I delivered prisoner from Jerusalem into the hands of the Romans. And when they had examined me, would have let me go, because there was no cause of death in me. But when the Jews spake against it, I was constrained. I felt I had no option, all right? I was constrained to appeal unto Caesar, not that I had aught to accuse my nation of. For this cause, therefore, I don't have anything against the Jews, all right? For this cause, therefore, have I called for you, to see you and to speak with you, because that for the hope of Israel, I am bound with this chain. This is just astounding to me that every time Paul speaks, it seems, he's going to talk about his Savior. And so even though he's just called these Jews, I'd like to talk with you guys because I want to tell you why I'm here. I'm here for the hope of Israel, your hope. All right, keep on reading. And they said unto him, We neither received letters out of Judea concerning thee, neither any of the brethren that came, showed, or spake any harm of thee. It seems as though the leaders over there in Jerusalem, once they got Paul out of the scene, all right, he's not going to bother us anymore. They can care less about it. They're not going to waste any more time on it. Verse 22, but we desire to hear of thee what thou thinkest, for as concerning this sect, now wait a second, are followers of Jesus Christ just a sect? It's not, all right? But the Jews thought of them that way. They felt like they were an ornery sect of Judaism. They were claiming that the Messiah had already come, and most of Judaism said, no, he's not here yet. They didn't want to follow Christ, the true Messiah. But their curiosity was risen, so for concerning the sect, we know that everywhere it is spoken against. So, when they had appointed him a day, there came many to him into his lodging. Talk about a packed house. He was in a rented house. All right. This is like the packed services. You've had them around here, right? Isn't that cool when God brings all kinds of people in your doors? All right. He's got a captive audience. What is he going to do? He's going to preach. That's what he's going to do. Look on. To whom he expounded and testified the kingdom of God, persuading them concerning Jesus, both out of the law of Moses and out of the prophets. This is my favorite phrase in the whole chapter. From morning till evening. Sit back, relax, folks. We're going to be here for a while. This, Paul went at it. He was unafraid to declare the gospel. Did they stop for lunch? It doesn't appear. All right. They came there after breakfast. Sorry, hang on. You're going to stay here all the way until supper. All right. But he was preaching the gospel. So verse 24, what happened? Some believed the things which were spoken, and some believed not. Now, if this was a myth, if this was a legend, if this was trying to glorify the work of Paul, that last part of verse 24 would not be there. But this is a reality check, folks. So I've pointed out three questions to ask ourselves. Does your life demonstrate the greatness of God? Do you give your life in service to others? And does your life cause others to give thanks to God and find encouragement? Right? Good three questions. Now I'm going to preach at you for 3 points real fast. All right? Number one, what do we see here? Let us always, may it be a part of who we are, because it's what Paul did. It's the final chapter to tell us to be just like that. Let us always share the truth with any who will listen. Share the truth with any who will listen. Now, what's the response? Well, it'll be just like this. Some believe and some won't. So should I quit? Should I give up? No, of course not. Keep sharing the truth. Who are you anyways? Are you the Savior? Of course not. You're just his herald. You're just his witness. You're just his spokesperson. That's all. But you better be a good one. Because he wants... I think there's this verse that says God loves the world and that God sent his son to die for the world and that he wants all the world to hear. And he's asked you and I to do that. So folks, when was the last time you told somebody about Jesus? That's what we're here for. Yes, to encourage one another. We've already seen all that. But at the end of the day, I'm here to preach the kingdom of God. That Christ has come to be the Savior. Now you say, well, it's been a while. Fine. I realize we live in a very fast-paced world that dissects us. We're on social media, and we don't talk to each other anymore. Knock it off and start talking. Oh, I'll share it on social media. Fine, but they still need a face-to-face. All right? Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Get it out there. Let us always ask God. You say, I'm scared. Ask God to give you courage. The Spirit of God lives within you. And then ask God to give you the opportunities. And go looking for them. Do you carry a track in your pocket? Or your purse? Be always prepared. Always ready. Paul said that, to give an answer of the hope that lieth within you. With meekness and fear. There was Paul. Just, okay, guys, come here. Come here, let me tell you about my Savior. Now, he preached for a long time. You say, I don't know if I have that many words. There's just a few of us that have got that many words, all right? That's fine. A few words about your dear Savior can go a long way in reaching that soul for Christ. All right, let's hasten on. Verse 25. And when they agreed not among themselves, they departed. After that, Paul had spoken one word. They say, well, there's more than one word. This is like the invitation, folks. All right? He preached all day. He sees the response. And he's going to give them one more word. All right? What did he say? Well spake the Holy Ghost by Isaiah the prophet unto our father, saying, go unto this people and say, hearing ye shall hear and shall not understand. And seeing ye shall see and not perceive. For the heart of this people is waxed gross. It's fat. It's heavy. And their ears are dull of hearing. And their eyes have they closed, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart and should be converted and I should heal them. Be it known therefore unto you that the salvation of God is sent unto the Gentiles. Now that's like anathema to the Jews. I'm going to keep on preaching, but now I'm going to preach to the Gentiles and that they will hear it. What's another point? All right, so I already told you, let's be about sharing the truth with all who will listen. But number two, when the opportunity is rejected, like the Jews did here, they rejected it. He quotes Isaiah and says, you're just like the prophecy. You've heard and you won't receive. You've chosen not to receive. Okay, fine. You're not going to hear? Well, that doesn't mean my job's done. I'm going to now start preaching to Gentiles here in Rome. All right? So when the opportunity is rejected, what should you do? Keep on going. Go find some others that will hear. You know that coworker that you've tried to witness to for the last 28 years? Any of you have guys like that? Okay, oh, okay. Well, don't forsake them. If he's alive, he still has the opportunity, all right? But there may be the coworker on the other side of the line that needs to hear today, that will receive. Well, go on to them. Paul was certain, because he had experienced so much through the book of Acts, that he starts preaching the gospel to the Gentiles, what will happen? There will be some that will hear. They're grateful for the Jews that believed. But Paul is just never going to stop. Folks, keep at it. Keep at it. Don't get discouraged. Your job is not to convert. That's the Holy Spirit's job. That's Christ's work. Your job is to keep speaking. Don't forsake the speaking. Verse 29. And when he had said these words, the Jews departed and had great reasonings among themselves. And Paul dwelt 2 whole years in his own hired house. By the way, what an interesting... How did he have a hired house if he wasn't working? It's called missionary support, folks. You know what you do to support missionaries around here? Well, keep on. They need it. The missionary support continued so that Paul could continue preaching. Amen? That provided a place for him, a location for him to sit, take care of. That's kind of cool. All right? So anyways, he dwelt in his own hired house and received all that came unto him. What was he doing during those 2 whole years? Well, verse 31, it's all wrapped up right there. Preaching the kingdom of God. Now, wait a second. We don't usually use those words today, do we? What's he talking about, preaching the kingdom of God? Well, obviously, there's this hope that Christ will come and rule and reign on this earth for 1,000 years, right? The millennial kingdom? Would that be a good thing to preach? I kind of think so. Hey, you want to be on this earth for the glory time? Why don't you get saved and be ready for it, all right? But more distinctly, who is king of the millennium? Christ, right? Can we experience some of the blessings and glory of Christ's future kingdom now? Ah, yes, we can. You let Christ rule and reign in your heart, and the blessings are rich and full. Even though I live in a wicked, sin-cursed world, I'm still in my flesh that struggles with sin. I can enjoy the kingship of Christ in my life. And should I not want others to hear about that? So he continued preaching the kingdom of God and teaching those things concerning the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, Master, Jesus, Savior, Christ. Anointed One. There's the gospel wrapped up in 3 simple titles. Have you received Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord? Have you believed that He's God's anointed salvation for you? That's what he continued preaching. And he did it with all confidence. I wonder why he did it with all confidence. Could it be because he got encouraged back there on the way to Rome? Isn't that something? That narrative tie all the way back there, he was encouraged, he picked up courage to keep on faithful. Now, I'll tell you as well, you know what happened? He wrote several epistles. Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, Philemon, all written during these 2 years here. We call them the prison epistles. Now, if you would read those epistles, guess what you're going to find? A lot about Jesus Christ. A lot. And will you find discouragement and disgruntlement? No. In fact, we find in those books, in whatsoever state I am, therewith to be content. Wow. May we do that today too. No wonder they didn't stop. The end of story. It's like, come on, folks, jump in. Let us, like Paul, be about proclaiming the kingdom of God and Jesus Christ. May that be our life story. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word today. Lord, there's work for us to do, and it's been very clearly set forth here in Acts chapter 28. As believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, help me to faithfully demonstrate your glory. Help me to faithfully serve others. Help me to cause others to give thanks to you and to find encouragement in doing what's right and good. But Lord, as we boil it down, may I continue to share the truth of the kingdom of God and the person of our Lord Jesus Christ. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed, no one looking about. Believer today, as God's word pricked your heart, I literally had 6 points. I'm not going to ask each one of those points, but maybe say, yes, Dr. Anderson, God has worked in my heart. And I want God to know by a raised hand that I want to follow him. I want to be that testimony. I want to be about his greatness. Would you pray that God would help me to do that? Yes, amen. I see hands already. Amen. Amen. Yes, amen. Yes, amen. Amen. Yes. Are you here today without the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior? I've not preached the gospel directly from this passage, although I've mentioned it several times. Do you know for sure that Christ is your Savior, that you are on your way to heaven, that the Spirit of God lives in you? Say, I'm not sure about this. Could I pray for you right now? I'm not sure I'm saved. I don't know that I've turned from my sin. I've got some questions about that. Well, I would love to pray for you right now. And just in a moment, when the invitation is given, you can come and talk to Pastor Troy. They'd be happy to have someone step aside and share the gospel with you, the gospel that Paul preached, the gospel that's recorded right here in the Word of God. It's not our words, it's God's words. And you could leave here today knowing for sure that your sins are forgiven, that you're on your way to heaven, that Christ lives in your life. You say, Dr. Anderson, that's my need today. Could you pray for me right now? No one's looking about you. Just quietly raise your hand. I'll be happy to pray for you. Anyone at all. That's my need today. Lord, take your word and do its good work on our heart and life. Thank you so much for the blessings of the example of Paul and others that show us how to live in this moment, at this time, being the continued work of Christ. May your glory shine through our lives. May your testimony be clear. It's in your name we pray. Pastor Troy, why don't you come?
I'll encourage you, please, to keep your head bowed and eyes closed. We want to give you a chance to talk to the Lord. We talk about worship all the time. We've been studying it from the book of Colossians, which is why we had bumped into Acts chapter 28. This is one of those letters that Pastor Dave mentioned that Paul had written. And we have been pursuing the comprehension of worship. Remember what we've learned? Worship isn't something that a man can offer you. It is a gift that you get to give to Christ. And the greatest gift that you could give him is your affection, your loyalty, your commitment, the absence of fear to share the gospel with others. Let's stand to our feet. I'd like to pray over our church family. And then if you want to talk to the Lord, we will give you a chance to do that. We'll give you a chance to worship. Maybe you want to get down on your knees, physically on your knees to pray to him. You're welcome to do that. You can come up to the front if you want. You could sit down where you are. But I hope that as God's child, you'll commit. There seems to me to be a response from every Christian that has heard this message, a commitment to share Jesus with others. And then I will add, if there is somebody that you're concerned about their salvation, you're concerned that they don't know the Lord, would you pray for them during this invitation time? Father, Lord, during these moments, of all of the things that you have received, our time, our attention, our affection, Lord, may you receive our heart. That is the place where we make our deepest commitments. Receive it as a gift unto yourself as we continue to worship you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. With heads bowed and eyes closed, as the piano begins to play, if you want to talk to the Lord, we'll give you a chance to worship him.
Thank you.
Father, thank you for the obvious ways that you are working in our hearts this morning. Thank you for bringing the Andersons safely to us. Thank you for Pastor Dave's dedication to serving you and to understanding your word and sharing it with others. Father, thank you for the understanding that you have given us, but so much more than that. Thank you for coming into our hearts and convicting us in areas where we can grow and give to you. Lord, help us not to feel defeated when we're confronted with failure, but ready for victory. Now, Lord, as we continue to move through this service, may you be the only one who receives all glory, for you are the only one worthy of it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you would, please grab your seats. We're going to go ahead and transition. We have several announcements that we need to take care of. I have a couple. Pastor Matt has several, but you're going to feel a really big disruption in the normal routine around here. I'd also like you all, in awe, to turn and look at the clock and see just how on schedule Dr. Anderson was able to keep us this morning, a task that I am not capable of at all. I will say this just briefly, because you hear preaching and you have an opinion of it. But let me say this as one who has studied preaching and desires to get continually better at it. I hope to continue to grow. When I was in Bible college, they taught us the different kinds of preaching. And they listed narrative as one of the kinds of preaching that you'll learn. And then our professor in Homiletics 3, which was a capstone class for us, you're getting ready to become a pastor, to preach and to teach. And so Homiletics 3 is the class where you learn to preach. And he listed narrative preaching. And one of the guys talked about how excited he was to do narrative preaching. And our professor said, I don't know if you guys will ever do narrative preaching in this class, because I guarantee every last one of you would have a failing grade in that task. And here's why. Narrative preaching, it's the hardest kind of preaching that you can do. And over the years, I have learned it really is. So when a man is able to stand up and the time flies by like it has, and to preach the most difficult fashion of scripture, the most difficult fashion of preaching with such ease, we ought to be very thankful. And I know that you want to take care of the Andersons for feeding us this morning. Believe me, if you're not sure, come on over to my house and I'll let you practice preaching to me, and then you'll understand how difficult preaching can be. It's easy to sit back and criticize a football game. It's hard to be in the game taking the actual hits. Pastor Dave, thank you for feeding us today. I know you guys want to love him and take care of him. We're going to take two offerings this morning. The first one is going to be our normal tithe. So if you've brought money that you want to honor God with, do that this morning. That's between you and him. After our first offering, we'll take up a second offering. That is designed to simply show some affection to the Andersons, to cover any costs that they would have, for him to have the discretion with the funds that we give to meet the needs both of his family as well as Maranatha. And so that gift is going to be directed toward you. We know that many of you want to be able to say thank you, that they have come here, sacrificed. They could have ran back to Watertown, but Pastor Dave wanted to worship with you all. And so we want to show him some love. That'll be the second offering that we take. All right, so first one is our normal offering for the ministry. Second one is for the Andersons. Now, you know that I consider tithing to be very, very sacred. And I'm not one to tell you what needs to be done between you and God. His word is clear. His Holy Spirit is living in you. So let me encourage you. If you had an offering that you were going to bring out of affection and you were going to put it in the first plate, can I encourage you to consider taking that offering and put it in the second plate and allow that love gift to go to the Andersons? We would love to know that they are well cared for. There are so many needs at Maranatha that often fall short. We'd love to be able to equip him to meet those as he sees fit. So those are the two offerings. Also, real quick, if you didn't pick up a nomination form and God has laid on your heart someone to nominate, those are due today. So anytime today, if you could, either this morning or this evening, turn those over to me. The nomination forms are in the back. So that closes out the first step in the process. So the nomination forms, again, are in the back. Those are due today. You can just hand them to me directly. And then one more announcement. This is completely different than what we ever normally do. Would you guys please grab your hymn books? Something really cool happened this week. Guys, go ahead for a second. We're going to transition. Brother Bill, go ahead and lose the plates for a second. I told you this would be very disruptive. All right? Go ahead and lose the plates, but I still need you guys. Brother Phil, you be ready. Go ahead and look at number 426. Now, if you don't know Faith Baptist Church, can someone quick grab me a John and Romans? Does someone have one on hand? Not your Bible, but one of our John and Romans. Brother Bill, go ahead and grab one of those. Yes, sir. I know with all these disruptions, I have your full attention. That is by design, okay? Thank you. So if you don't know about our John and Romans project, here at Faith Baptist Church, once a year, we partner with Brother Dan and Kelly Gill out of Milford, Ohio, First Baptist Church of Milford. They have Bearing Precious Seed. That's a Bible printing ministry down there. God has provided for them the ability to print more Bibles than they can physically put together and distribute. And so they found a creative way to get churches involved. If you go down to First Baptist Church in Milford, Ohio, I would guess you're going to worship with like 800 to 1,000 people. It's a very big ministry. But even with all that help, the printing machine that God has blessed them with can put out pages of scripture faster than they can be put together. And so they prayed about this problem and came up with a solution about a decade ago called the Seed Line. Bearing Precious Seed started a very special ministry where they took the seed, God's word, and created a line to the local churches. We have been involved in this project. The first project, we were going to do 5,000. We had so many volunteers, we ended up doing 10,000 scriptures. And since then, we've done 20,000 each year. 5,000 for us, 15,000 for foreign missions. And so we have our own printed John and Romans that our church family has assembled. See, man, that sounds amazing. I'd like to be a part of that. We would love for you to be a part of it. You're welcome to be. And we'll be doing that probably in the springtime. So kind of stick around for that. But if these don't get into people's hands, it doesn't matter that they're paid for. It doesn't matter that they've been printed, and it doesn't matter that they've been assembled and lovingly packaged. It doesn't even matter that they've been prayed over if we're not giving them out. And so some of you have taken this ministry very, very seriously. Before we left on sabbatical, on our holiday, this was a burden of mine, trying to figure out how to support those of you who are so faithful at giving out these John and Romans. And this week, one of you, and I tell you this story because I want you to see how God can use you. You may be the next person that comes up with this idea. So we had one of you, I won't embarrass her, but she reached out to Cherry first and asked if it would be okay and then reached out to me. But one of you in our church family, one of our members, had a burden for all of the people that are suffering from Hurricane Helene and now, Milton, I believe? We know people and are well connected with people that are suffering down there. They're represented well in our church family. Now, all the kids are downstairs. We have mostly older kids, so I'll be very candid. The things that those folks are seeing down there are much worse than just collapsed houses. They are finding people's bodies, and they are looking for their own family. The things that they are seeing down there are shattering their souls as well as their mental being. And what's incredible is, as Americans, as divided as we have been, are raising up to take care of each other. You may not realize this, but private pilots, helicopters are the only way to get down there right now. So guys all around the country, from the West Coast to the East Coast, from the northern border all the way to the southern, have taken their helicopters and they've gathered around those five states that got hammered by Hurricane Helene. And they are flying supplies to these people that are stuck on the hillsides. And they are trying to help find. I saw a picture of a 3x5 card that one pilot was handed, his mission. His mission was to deliver water, food, and bring back three dead bodies. They are shattered and they are broken and they need Jesus Christ. Some will believe. And one of you reached out of concern to our household, Cherry first, and then directly to me, and said, this bothered me so much, I started working on social media, and Pastor, I made a connection with a pilot who understands the need to get Bibles down there. And so this pilot, she's offered, if we will ship the Bibles to her house, our Bibles, she'll take that case and give them to all the people that are suffering down there in that hurricane territory. Now, you say, how can I get involved with this project? This is where the idea of Rescue Line came from. Rescue Line is turning our Seed Line project into a rescue mission. That's the idea. Every single time one of these Bibles is handed out, you have been a part of our Rescue Line. My favorite hymn has always been this hymn since I was a little boy. You're open to it right now, number 426. Throw out the lifeline. Someone is struggling, is hurting, is sinking. And we want to give you the chance to live out the message that you just heard preached. Share the gospel with someone. We already have someone that is committed to one case first. Man, are we excited about this. Can you tell I'm a little excited? I was chomping at the bit all morning to get ready to tell you this. So here's what I'd like to do. We're going to sing just the first verse of my favorite hymn, number 426, Throw Out the Lifeline. But before we do, the guys are going to help me. I've asked Brother Phil, one of our deacons, sir, if you wouldn't mind coming to the front. We will have to retape this case. But we're going to open this case up. Brother Phil, do you have a pocket knife on you, sir? Amen. Just go ahead and set them down right here. Ushers, if you wouldn't mind coming forward. Men, if I could have a couple other guys that are willing to volunteer. We're going to hand out, every single one of you is going to hold one of these Bibles in your hand. We're going to sing this song, and you have the chance. I'm not going to force you to do this, but with a Bible in your hand and Throw Out the Lifeline playing, we're going to give you one verse to pray over one of these Bibles that is going down to our fellow countrymen down in one of the five southern states that have been affected by this hurricane. Go ahead, guys, start passing them out. We want every single one of you to be holding one of these Bibles, okay? Now, at the conclusion of the service, this box will be in the back with me. Bring that back with you. After you have prayed over it, put it back in the box. We'll button this thing up. We are shipping it down to North Carolina, and one of the volunteer pilots is going to go all over and distribute these John and Romans. About 350 copies of God's Word are going to be distributed down there for us, and we want you to be a part of that this morning. So if you're confused, you're getting a John and Romans right now. We're going to sing this song, and this is the launch of our new Rescue Line ministry. You're going to hear this. I am begging you, if you come up with an idea of a way to get our John and Romans out, get as creative as you can possibly get. We are running out of time. Do you believe that we're in the last days? Think about this. If the Lord Jesus returns and leaves this building vacant, we have multiple cases of these Bibles that will be stuck in this basement. This place will be locked, and there will be no one to give it out to the people that are all around us right now that don't know the Lord. So we're going to launch our Rescue Line today with a moment of prayer during this song. You can remain seated. It's probably the best way to do it. We're going to sing Throw Out the Lifeline. I'm curious. Brother Paul said, Pastor, I'm not sure I'm familiar with this one. That's okay. I'll lead it. I'm excited too. And so I'll lead this song. I'm curious, how many of you are familiar with this song? Pastor Dave, help me, sir. Amen. All right. I see several of you do know this song. We're going to sing one verse of this song, and then my wife is going to play through one verse. During that one verse, you are invited to pray for the person that is going to receive that Bible that is in your hands. Remember, every one of these Bibles has been taken off the top of this case. They will be the first Bibles that are handed out. So what are the chances that you're praying over a Bible that one of your fellow countrymen desperately needs? 100%. And so we'll give you a chance during that verse to pray over this Bible. You'll become a part of the Rescue Line. You don't even have to be a member at Faith Baptist Church. You just got to help get these out. And then we'll do one verse, and then I will pray over Rescue Line ministry. And then when that's done, Pastor Matt's going to come, because this is all announcements, people. Can you believe it? We're just getting a lot out of announcements this morning. When we're done with this portion of the announcements, Pastor Matt's going to come take care of a couple more announcements. We'll take up our first offering, which is for the ministry here, and then we will take up a second offering with our final song, which will be for Pastor Dave, for Dr. Anderson and his family. So let's go ahead and sing Throw Out the Lifeline, and then we'll give you a chance to pray over the Bible that is in your hands.
Through lifeline across the dark wave. There is a brother whom someone should save. Somebody's brother.
Take a moment to pray over that Bible. Father, we are so grateful for the way that you move in our hearts. Thank you for raising up one of our church members to not only have a creative solution to sharing the gospel with people that are hurting, but Lord, the dedication to follow through and to make all the connections necessary for us. Father, we pray that as this box, this case is shipped out to North Carolina tomorrow during business hours, Lord, we pray for every mail carrier that touches it. Pray for the pilot for safety as she delivers these Bibles. We pray for the hurting hearts that receive them, that they would open up just a portion of your word and allow you to transform their lives. Lord, we live in peace, not because the weather is good in Michigan, but because no matter what the weather is like, as your children, we know that we can be right with you. So whether it's a cancer diagnosis or the birth of a brand new child, you are all that we need. So, Father, we pray for those that don't know you, for those that are represented by this case of Bibles, we ask that they would come to know you as Savior. Whether we hear of it or not, it matters that you know them. So as you have begun a good work in us, we trust you to complete it until the day of your return. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Some of you may be wondering, how are we going to afford to ship this entire case of Bibles? It weighs about 35 pounds. I want you to consider this. We already have $50 that is being given to shipping this case. $50 for 300 souls? The real expense isn't the money. It was the creativity to get these Bibles down there. And so I hope if God lays it on your heart and mind, you come up with an idea, please share it with us. I hope you realize how excited we are when God works in your life. And so just as a reminder, when you depart today, you guys are, you're kind of looking blank. You realize how awesome this is? Can I get an amen? Not a Baptist kind, a Pentecostal kind. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Testify. These are good things. There is nothing more worth being excited about than the redemption of souls. And so I hope you'll please take this to heart. Get fired up because God has just started something that is bigger than all of us. We want you to be a part of Rescue Line. So when you leave, the Bibles will be in the back with me. So just make sure I get one and then I will drop it back in the box for you. And then we will get it shipped out, okay? Pastor Matt is going to take care of several other announcements. And then we've got first offering, second offering this morning. All right, Pastor Matt.
All right, moving through these announcements as quickly as we can. Looking forward to tonight as Dr. Marriott is joining us for a special service. We're not going to have the normal, we had faith builders. We're just going to have a traditional Sunday evening service with Dr. Marriott, and we're looking forward to it. Hopefully everyone can come back for a wonderful time tonight. Pastor is resuming his Colossians series next week, has been a wonderful time as we have been studying through the book of Colossians and understanding what worship is, genuine worship. So come on back next week at 10:30 as we continue that series. We have our midweek services, expeditions for the kids, youth group for the teenagers, and prayer meeting for everybody else. Hopefully there's something for everyone. Hopefully you can be there with us for any of those services. We have our new church number up there. Again, please use that church line. You can text it, you can call it. Whatever we can do to help, we want to do that. And so we have that new number to make that possible, that somebody is able to help you as your need comes up. Moving on through, we also have coming up our annual church hayride, which is this Friday. If you have not signed up on the sign-up sheets in the back, please do so. Reminder, there are two sign-up sheets. Please sign up for both of them. One of them is to give an account of how many people you are bringing. If it's just you and your wife, perfect, just put two. If it's you and your 10 kids, perfect, put 11 down. Whatever it is, please make sure you sign up in those sign-up sheets. And there is another one as well for bringing a dish, a soup, or there's a whole list of things that you can bring. Please make sure that you sign up on that for this coming Friday. We have the annual church business meeting also next Sunday after the morning service, followed by a luncheon after the morning service, and then transitioning into the business meeting. Please be there for that. There are sign-up sheets on the back for desserts, as well as bringing like a side dish. Please make sure you sign up on those sign-up sheets if you're planning to be here for the luncheon. Do not miss that opportunity. I want to get your name on there. And we have Faith Builders resuming on the Sunday following, on October 27th. We are excited as Pastor is resuming Faith Builders, answering your questions about the Bible. Many of us have those questions, and sometimes we're just too afraid to ask them. And so Pastor's come up with a creative way and making sure that you can get those answers on a card. You can put your name on it if you want. Put it in Pastor's hands, and he does the best that he can with Scripture and answering those questions in a most informative way in a classroom setting on Sunday nights. So that takes care of our announcements. Ushers are preparing and coming up to the front for our offering, and then Brother Phil's going to be praying for that offering. This is our traditional offering, and then our love gift to Dr. Anderson will be after this.
Let us pray. Our dear gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this glorious day you've given to us. Thank you for the message through Dr. Anderson. And Lord, we pray as we leave this place, not only this week, throughout the rest of our lives, that we will be able to have the boldness and the strength through you only, Lord, to reach the lost. We thank you, Lord, for this ministry. We pray now as we take these tithes that they will be used here and around the world, Lord, for your purpose and your glory. And we give you all the thanks and praise for all that you've given to us and done for us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thank you.
All right, Brother Paul is going to come and lead us in our last song before closing prayer. And during this last song, we will take that love gift. If you're able to give something, great. If you can't, don't feel bad. You know, it's tough to pass the plate twice. I would almost just rather take one offering to take care of the Andersons, but we want to give you the chance to worship in every dimension that God has led you to do so. So the guys, go ahead and make your way to the front. Brother Paul's going to come lead us in our last song, and then we will work on getting you out this morning with closing prayer.
Let's turn our hymn books to 207. Number 207, Oh Happy Day. Stand and we'll pray and close in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for this day. Thank you, Lord, for the word that was preached. We thank you for Dr. Anderson and his family being here. Father, we just pray that you would bless them as they travel. Lord, we ask you to just bless this day for our people, Lord, that we would be able to honor and glorify you with service. Father, that we would love you even more. Pray that you would bless this afternoon, that you would keep us safe as we go to our homes. We just pray you would bring us back again at the appointed hour. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Mm-hmm.